Okay. Good afternoon. We continue. Today is relatively simple, I hope. Yes, those two lectures here at home. So we will go through them briefly, and then maybe solve some small example. Okay. So we learned the conjugate gradient last time, and now the one of applications to use it inside Newton method. So actually, we already learned that in Newton method we optimize at every iteration we minimize quadratic model of our function. And we know that conjugate gradient is good in minimization of convex quadratic functions. So if the Hessian is positive definite, so we have this quadratic function with respect to displacement, our Newton step, and the world truncated Newton means that we do not solve it till n, because maybe we have many thousands of variables, but we solve it with reasonable accuracy, say using 20 or 100 conjugate gradient steps, and then do line searching in this direction which we obtained after 20 conjugate gradient steps, and continue so on. The only technical details in the process of conjugate gradient, you know that the basic operation is to multiply the matrix which is in quadratic function by some vectors. This is basic conjugate gradient operation. And if we don't want to compute our Hessian matrix, interestingly, we still can have a Hessian multiplication by arbitrary vector, very inexpensive. We will learn it in the next lessons. You will have a Jacobian computation, some lecture in the future related to neural networks. Now you just should believe me that if I have a function, first of all, computing gradient, it's about the same as computing function, if I do it in clean and clear form. And the second message, multiplying Hessian by arbitrary vector, it's also about as a computing gradient, even if you want to do it exactly. One more possibility, if we want to do it approximately, we have this nice relation that Hessian Hessian multiplied by dx is dg. So if I want to put it here, I would say, if I say that my dx is some epsilon multiplied by some vector z, then I get this relation that from this formula you can think a little bit and get this expression, which is very interesting. So to multiply Hessian by arbitrary vector, approximately, if I don't have, if I'm lazy and didn't do it analytically, or I have my function as black box, which only is able to compute function and gradient and doesn't provide Hessian, I just do small increment of argument in direction z, and compute gradient, and difference this gradient divided by epsilon gives me Hessian vector. Okay, any question, any comment? We finished with truncated Newton, we'll pass to quasi-Newton. Any question, any comment on this? Yes.
What does it help you to multiply the Hessian by an arbitrary vector? You need to complicate to solve the equation of the Hessian multiplied by D is minus the gradient. How does it help you to solve this equation?
I minimize this quadratic function. Mm-hmm. When you look back on previous previous lecture, and you ask, how do I minimize quadratic function with method of conjugate gradient? Oh. You will discover that there will be conjugate directions and so on, and the basic operation will be multiplication of my matrix in quadratic function by some vectors. So this is now I am my general question: what is product of Hessian by arbitrary vector? And I am clever enough to do it in non-expensive, without computing important methods, without computing Hessian, because I may have a problem with a million of variables, and I even cannot store matrix million by million. But still, I am able to do it. Yes.
Can you give some intuition why this problem is why the solution of this problem is close to the solution of the
original? Yeah. I remind you the idea of Newton method. Newton method. I am staying at some point, and I consider quadratic approximation, second order Taylor expansion of my function at this point, and go to the minimum of this quadratic approximation. This is exactly what I'm trying to do here. And the question how technically to do it. We did it analytically by solving Newton system. We just conditioned gradient, equated gradient of this quadratic function to zero and get standard Newton formula. But if we are not able to store this matrix and to invert this matrix, we just do several steps in minimizing this quadratic function. And this is ideal. Okay. Moving next. Okay, this is not in our program. And now we move to quasi-Newton. And the lecture, I think it was rather simple. I just very briefly go through it. On the base of gradients which we had on the way, we form approximation of inverse Hessian. And this, instead of real inverse Hessian, which we use usually in Newton method to compute direction, inverse Hessian by gradient, we use this approximate inverse Hessian. And we do line search in this obtained Newton direction, quasi-Newton direction. And then we will update, compute more accurate approximation of inverse Hessian based on new information. We got new gradients and new displacements. And this allows us to be even more accurate. And the basic equation is the same. H multiplied by dx is dg. We want our approximation of Hessian satisfy this equation for all pairs of dx, delta x and delta g, which we had on the way of our algorithm. And rather simple manipulation give us this so-called first rank one update formula. So we have a previous Hessian, and we compute some auxiliary vectors and have this nice formula. So we start, for example, with identity matrix or some diagonal matrix, reasonable diagonal matrix. Or reasonable approximation of inverse Hessian, if you already have it, and get this simple update. Yes.
Why would it work if I use an arbitrary diagonal matrix that is not related to the Hessian whatsoever? If I use the I matrix and then I do the update every time, why would it converge to the Hessian?
Because with update, I force my Hessian to satisfy this second condition, this difference of gradients and difference of axis, and then after second update, I wanted to satisfy the second difference. I am not guaranteed that I will not destroy the first one, but okay, there are sophisticated proofs why this works. I only give you idea that at every new iteration, I want to satisfy this condition with the hope that old condition will not be destroyed too much, and gradually I will get to the to my model of Hessian. And this update, as we did it, is symmetric, but we don't guarantee at this point positive definiteness of the matrix. We guarantee only symmetricity, and we get similar procedure for inverse. We luckily can update directly inverse Hessian, so we don't need to solve system of equation, which is a great advantage actually for the method. And idea. If I have rank one update of a matrix, and for example I have inverse of this matrix, and the formula and the question whether I can get approximation to the inverse of the updated, whether I can update, whether if I do rank one update for a matrix, and I already knew its inverse, that I can easily compute inverse of updated matrix. And I did it by simple trick, but in general there is a Sherman-Morrison formula which says you exactly this. If I add to A some rank one matrix, then it's just formula what will be inverse of A. What if we do a simple exercise? Let's do an exercise. Let's try. Where can I write? Maybe here. Let's try to develop this formula and start even with more simple example. Let's try to show what is I plus UV transpose. If I have, I want to get in inverse, but to derive the formula, I do even more simple thing. I have an equation A UV transpose X is equal to B. And what I ask you, please try to find the x. Just solve this system of equations. X is a vector. So u is a column, v is a row, and I even can give you a hint. If you multiply v transpose by x, you get some scalar. Try first to estimate the scalar, and this is our first exercise, and I will leave you for a couple of minutes. Let's finish. Let's just finish this video.